Chattanooga pick up my boys. They've been away for 2 weeks at sports camp. They've been gone since last month. So they'll pick them up, spend a good family weekend.
What's there? Or?
Yes, sir. Yeah. We're going to tour the aquarium. And, just get a good weekend away.
We'll give some air conditioning.
Really? So, thanks.
I appreciate that.
Hey, Charlie.
Hi there.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
How are you? Good to see you. How are you? Warren McDonald.
Yes, sir.
Oh, gosh. How are you? Good to see you. How are you?
What have you done?
Isn't that what Ted Paxton said?
What?
When he was drunk underground? What have you done?
I'm good, how are you?
What have you done?
What have you done?
Yeah. I really like the way you handled that guy who was mad at you for, I have no idea why.
He was mad. He was going to blow off on somebody, and I guess you became his target.
He was looking for somebody.
Well, you know, when you're my size, people do that to me, too.
The next traffic light, rather than turning left and continuing around the Pajet Square, goes straight. That is Pilgrim Road, and it's up about maybe half mile on the right hand side.
Hello, Mr. Piper.
How are you?
Doing very well, thank you.
You're from Roswell?
Yes, I am.
So what all do you do?
I'm a blogger.
You're a blogger? Okay.
One
we are pleased to have you here tonight. And we're pleased to welcome our three candidates for Forsyth County Sheriff. To my immediate left, we have Mr. Lauren McDonald, we have Mr. Ted Paxton, and also Mr. Duane Piper. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us. Thank you. We will begin our debate here shortly, but we'd like to make sure everyone understands the rules. Each candidate will be given 2 minutes to introduce himself and to state why he's running for office and why he feels he's the best candidate. Following the introductions, we'll move to a questioning period. Questions were developed by unanimous consent of the Forsyth County GOP's Executive Committee, and we'll be asking the question. Each candidate will have a 1 minute period to answer, and then we'll go back around and allow each candidate to rebut to the same answer. The intent is to create a dialogue and to be able to respond to your opponent's responses to each question. So you'll have a total of 2 minutes to respond, and we'll break it up in 1 minute periods each. Once we get through the question period, you will have 1.5 minutes to make the closing responses. To our right is Mr. Joel Knapp. He's going to be our official timekeeper. Please keep an eye on him. He'll be giving you signals. We have 1 minute and 15 seconds, and then we time it out. And we do want to make sure we keep to the clock. Our other rules we have is that no candidate is allowed to send or receive text messages during the debate, and we look forward to a lively discussion about why you're the best candidate and why you need to be carrying the Republican banner as our sheriff's nominee. We'll start immediately to my left, and we'll let Mr. Ron McDonald make his opening statements.
Thank you, Ethan. Thank you, Republican Party. Thank you all for being here. I see a lot of familiar faces from all the other debates, but I still appreciate y'all taking the time away from your families. First day of summer, great day, great hot day. Great day to campaign. I am Lauren McDonald, and I want to be your next sheriff. I moved to this community 15 years ago. I chose to move here. I chose to build my business here and chose to raise my family here. During that time, my investment that I've made is paralleling everything that I want to do today. I want to invest back in this community with my service. At your corner of 11 and a half years, I've worked parallel with the sheriff's office. I've investigated many deaths throughout this community, some real tough situations from the antifreeze case to the assisted suicide cases. And that was done inside the city of Cumming. And that was done through our coroner's office working with the Georgia Bureau of Investigations. That has made me shown that my leadership through the coroner's office, my leadership and my business makes me the best candidate for the sheriff's office. Some of the things that we need to do is, as sheriff, we need to get back and get in the lives of our children. We've got to get in our schools. We've got to let these kids know the repercussions, the decisions that they're making today will be with them. They will be with them the rest of their life. We've got to let them understand, get the foundation built back for them so that they know right from wrong. And it starts a lot with the sheriff's office in our school system. I want to thank my wife and my daughter, Haley. They're here with me tonight. Fortunately, my two boys, they're at camp for 2 weeks. I never thought I'd miss my two boys, but I do, and I'm ready to pick them up this Saturday. So we're going to have a day away from the campaign and have a family weekend in Chattanooga picking up my kids at Mall High School. But again, I want to thank the party. Thank you all for taking the time to come out tonight.
Thank you, Ethan, and I too would like to thank the Republican Party for putting on this forum tonight and giving us the opportunity to have all of you here. Once again, thank each and every one of you for being here and taking the time to participate. My name is Ted Paxton. I have had the honor to serve this community as your sheriff since 2001. During that time, as all of you are well aware, our county has seen a tremendous amount of growth. We have been transformed from a small rural county in the northern foothills of Georgia to now a very vibrant part of the urban Atlanta area. And with that, we've grown the sheriff's office, managed the sheriff's office to meet the needs of all the new growth that came into the county. During that time, in 2003, I led the agency through being accredited by the Commission on Accreditation of Law Enforcement Agencies. It's a voluntary program which we participate in to demonstrate to the members of this community that we are dedicated to the highest levels of professionalism in law enforcement to serve the people in this community. Over the years, we've been very, very fortunate where we have received a tremendous number of awards, recognitions from national law enforcement associations as to the work we do here locally in Forsyth County. As we look to the future, the biggest endeavor we have facing us right now, as far as the Sheriff's Office is concerned, is the construction of a new jail. As you're well aware, back last November, voters of the county approved a local option sales tax to pay for the construction of a new jail and a new courthouse. Those projects are underway, and it's my commitment that the jail portion of that project comes in on time, as can be done, and well within its budget. Thank you very much once again. It's been an honor to serve you as your sheriff, and I look forward to continuing to serve in that capacity. Thank you.
Last but not least, Mr. Duane Piper.
I want to thank the Republican Party for hosting the event, but most of all, thank you all for taking the time to be here. My name is Duane Piper, and I'm running for sheriff of Forsyth County. My wife and I moved here about 19 years ago. We raised our two children here. Our daughter-in-law is from this area, which means that my granddaughters are going to be growing up in Forsyth County. I have a vested interest in our community. After 4 years in the military, in the 82nd Airborne Division, I've spent 25 years in law enforcement. A very broad range of experience in law enforcement. I've been had the advantage of having worked under a wide variety of leaders with different leadership styles. Tonight I'll be presenting you with some information, some facts. The source of the information is open records requests and the county's website. During three terms of the incumbents, well, the sheriff's been coming for the past three terms, the budget started out at about $12.5 million. At this point, the budget is $37.5 million. That is a 199% increase. We've tripled our sheriff's office budget. At the same time, the county's population only grew by 78%. I mention this because that's a very disturbing trend when you consider the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office consumes 41% of the county's overall operational budget. This has got to be gotten up. We have to get this under control. As your sheriff, I will bring fiscal responsibility to Forsyth County Sheriff's Office. I will turn the focus on serving the community so that we can maintain the community we all chose to live in. Thank you.
Now enter into the question period. If we could, we'll ask that the audience hold its applause and we can get through the questions. The longer y'all applaud, the less time we have to answer the questions. So we want to get as many questions and get as much information out as possible. Our first question, Mr. McDonald, you lead off. Is the county's police force too large, too small, or the right size to address the needs of Forsyth County residents?
I think the management of the office, I mean, there are 370 employees in the sheriff's office, about 290 sworn officers. I think the main thing is finding the focus of these officers and put them in the role that they're skilled to do. Looking at the placement, we've got 52 sworn officers in our courthouse. That's a courthouse where when you walk in, you walk through a scanner, you put your personals through an x-ray machine. I think, you know, that is a safe environment. I mean, that is something I think we really need to look at and possibly taking some of those resources and putting them into our schools. There are 47 detectives, both in SVU and in white collar crime. I think looking at that, some of those resources can be deployed in other areas. Yeah, there are a lot of officers out on the road, but it's our job to protect ourselves and our own. The officers are there to react to if you call them. They show up and take a report.
Sheriff Paxton, would you give me the repeat question?
Yeah, if you would please.
Is the county's police force too large, too small, or the right size to address the needs of Forsyth County's residents?
Well, start off with, the county doesn't have a police force. The county is served by the sheriff's office. The recommended staffing from both all three disciplines in law enforcement, National Sheriff's Association, International Association of Chiefs of Police, and also the FBI,
recommend that in an urban setting such as ours, that we have 2.5 officers per 1,000 population. Yes, we have 387 approved positions of employees at the sheriff's office. However, the actual number of certified deputies is only right at 300. The remainder of those employees are retention officers and the administrative staff. Our current ratio is running at about 1.6 to 1.7 officers per 1,000 population. We'd set a goal many years ago to try to get to a 2.0 ratio. Unfortunately, revenues have not allowed us to do that, but we are doing well with what we've got. Thank you.
Mr. Piper.
I don't think trying to put an exact number on it, but going by national statistics is the way to go with numbers of officers. What we need to be doing is looking at what we're doing, looking at crime trends, looking at what's happened in the past, and what we anticipate the crime to be in the future, and placing our manpower in those directions to try to set, to try to go by national numbers. Those numbers come from various different types of communities. Might not have the same crime rates that we have, probably don't have the same crime rates we have. Forsyth County enjoys a very low crime rate, but the main reason for a low crime rate is the folks that live here, the people who live here are not committing crimes. So to put an exact number on it would be a mistake until you actually sit down and figure out what's been going on and in which direction you're going to go.
Mr. McDonald, any rebuttal? Sheriff.
Yeah, if you would, there's made mention of the fact the number of deputies are assigned to core security. They do much more than just stand at the front door and check you when you come in. We have four courtrooms in that courthouse that have to be secured all the time with the activities going on in there. The other thing that we need to be mindful of and realize is that we have three separate courts in operation in three separate locations. And so all the people assigned to the core security are, yes, in core security, but they're at different locations. We have us at the courthouse, we have a magistrate court in session up on Sony Drive, we have a juvenile court which is in session up on 400 at Ball Ridge Marina. And we require by statute, by Georgia law, to provide proper security for each one of those facilities. Other than that, when you talk about not paying attention to recommendations, I'm sorry. I think that it's very important you pay attention to recommendations of all the leading law enforcement officials in the country who have established the right type of formulas that should be used to establish how you should be staffed.
Mr. Piper, can you rebut?
I'd rather pay attention to our own community rather than listen to somebody from the federal government tell me how many officers we need or don't need. Far be it for me to echo my opponent, but I agree with Sheriff Paxton on the court staffing and court security. Right now, we're so spread out. We've got courthouses in five different buildings. It takes a lot of people, and I think that at this moment right now, it would be a wrong time to try to cut those people.
Thank you. Sheriff Paxton, you can lead off our next question. How do you intend to utilize the Sheriff's Department to combat the spread of illegal drugs in Forsyth County?
It's a rather broad question, but we do it now. We have a narcotics unit that is dedicated to the investigation and enforcement of narcotics laws. That unit has been very successful, working also with our school resource officers in schools who are able to garner information from there with what's going on. Just recently, they made a very significant arrest of four juvenile, well, two of them are actually 16 to 17, who were major suppliers of marijuana into our high schools. And that information came out of a tip from the schools, and they were able to make controlled buys from each and every one of those individuals over a period of time to be able to bring that case to fruition. Just recently, thank goodness, the State Pharmacy Board gave us the tools and the resources to be able to eradicate and remove from the shelves of these stores in the county all this synthetic marijuana. We did it immediately once we got the authority to do so, and we're going to continue to monitor those establishments.
Mr. Piper, you need me to repeat the question? How do you intend to utilize the Sheriff's Department to combat the spread of illegal drugs in Forsyth County?
We do have a narcotics unit. As a matter of fact, I was a lieutenant of the narcotics unit for about 6 years. I have some ideas on that. The narcotics unit itself, I think, could be dedicated more towards longer term, more in-depth investigations. And we could go to training type of thing, training our road officers to be more effective in the street level narcotics and addiction type of thing. Our training budget for 2012 in the operational budget is only budgeted for $23,000. We're spending our money in the wrong places. $23,000 split up over 382 employees is only $60 per person per year. We're not putting our money in the right places. We'd have much more effective use of our money if we trained our officers. It's also morale of the officers improved.
Mr. McDonald, are you going to repeat the question?
Yes. I think it's important to put more resources. The drug problem is out there. I, as coroner, 3 weeks ago, I had two heroin overdoses, a 30-year-old and a 32-year-old, same weekend. It was tragic. And I think, you know, it's coming to our community. As the state pharmaceutical departments have shut down a lot of these pain clinics, and it's made it harder to get some of the Oxycontins and hydrocodones. These people that are addicted to this are now going back to heroin, and it's coming in our community. It's in Atlanta, and unfortunately, it's sent up here. It's purchased and brought up here and sold, and it is everywhere in our community. We need to get a handle on it. We need to use the drug resource funds and infuse those in our school system, and let these guys in the drug task force educate, as Mr. Piper said, these officers. These school resource officers about what's out in our community. Make sure there's a constant dialogue between the two so that they do keep them aware of what's in our schools.
Chair Paxton, can you rebut?
You talk about reassigning resources. We have the number of personnel that we approved to have, no more, no less. Number of inquiries we have set by the Board of Commissioners, and as a sheriff, I have to sit back and try to strike the balance on what is the correct and most efficient way to assign those people. Each and every day, we have people that want all the deputies on their street, or all the deputies over here doing this. We've had a situation here lately where an individual has made traffic complaints about it. He expects to have a deputy sitting at that intersection every day writing tickets for people running the stop sign. Well, it's impossible for us to do that. When we have everybody allocated appropriately in staffing levels to accomplish our goal, training is beyond what is required by statute. Our training department does do that. And as long as you got a lot of good ideas that shouldn't have been done, I would love them when you were working there. You can step forward and announce something that you thought would be a better idea.
Mr. Piper?
A good way to combat drugs is also to actually implement a community-oriented policing model. Community-oriented policing model is having officers that work in a specific area of the county, and that is their area. So that when folks have a problem, they have the same officers all the time. The officer knows the people in the area. He knows who moves around where. He knows who comes home late at night. He knows he shouldn't be there. We're presently not using that model. That model alone would greatly assist the narcotics unit in combating the drug problem.
Mr. McDonald, can you rebut? Our next question, Mr. Piper, can lead off. What qualifications do you have to make you the best candidate to serve the sheriff?
To start out with, I've been in law enforcement for 25 years. Progressively moving up as I've come through, I've got nearly 3,000 hours of continuing training. I've worked in virtually every aspect of the law enforcement field, from patrol to investigations, narcotics, internal affairs, detention. The only thing I really haven't ever been is a traffic officer. Traffic just never was a very large interest of mine. But through all this, I've learned from, as I said before, a wide variety of leaders. I've got some good business models. I've seen things that work. I've seen things that don't work. I've seen leadership styles that build up an agency. I've seen leadership styles that the tear-down agency. I believe bringing this experience and a new way of doing things is what the county needs right now. Mr. Gump?
I look at the last debate here. One of the other candidates said I had no business being on this stage and no business running for sheriff. I look at what we need as the next sheriff in this community is someone with ethics, leadership, character, and trust. Someone that knows who the customer is out there. I have to know that in my personal business. My management style, the role model I set not only at my home for my children, but I set in my personal business and the example that I set out here in the community through civic organizations, Rotary, etc., that has shown that you don't need someone that's driven a patrol car and pull people over and run blue lights. This community needs a leader, somebody to be a liaison between you, the customer, and the deputies out there on the road. I will put the right people in the right place to represent you in the sheriff's office, and I will be the best sheriff ever in the history of this community.
Great Paxton.
Thank you. Start off with, I hold a bachelor's degree in criminal justice from Georgia State University. I am a graduate of the Southern Police Institute at the University of Louisville, which is an administrative officer's course designed for executives delivering management in law enforcement agencies. I'm a graduate of the National Sheriff's Academy in Longmont, Colorado. In addition to that, I have amassed a tremendous number of hours in training outside those particular things that I saw myself. I've been in law enforcement for 40 years. It's the only thing I've done, the only job I've ever done. I've dedicated my entire career to this, and I have done it in the most professional manner. As we continue to go forward, thank you.
Mr. Piper, anything you want to add? Mr. Hill? Sheriff Paxton?
No.
This next question will be led off by Mr. McDonald. Can the sheriff's office be run more efficiently? And if so, how would you do that?
Of course, a lot of topics have been about the budget, the $37.5 million. You know, you look at a budget like that and you look at it from a business perspective. I think, you know, the budget is there. Yes, you always like to cut. Even my personal business, I look for areas to cut. And I look for areas to cut not only in staff, which sometimes you can't do. I think just overall grabbing a hold of the budget and managing, seeing where you are today and trying to look at the thick layers of misappropriated of funds with the staff and trying to cut some of that out, I think that's the first place that we need to look as the sheriff. And of course, that when you've got overhead like that, you're not only cutting staff, you also, the take-home cars, the gas, the health care, those are areas that you can do without when you cut that.
Sheriff Paxton, can the sheriff's office be run more efficiently, and if so, how would you do that?
Well, I think the inference is it's not being run efficiently. Yes, by that question. Well, I would take it that way, so therefore, you know, my position is it is being run efficiently. We've come a tremendous distance in the last decade on where we are in law enforcement in this community, and it is being run efficiently. A lot of talk about the budget, the budget is set by the Board of Commissioners, not the sheriff. It's just my job to manage the budget. And the budget is what it is, to provide the law enforcement services which is demanded by the people in this community. Efficiency, we hear a lot about staffing and too many supervisors. Well, it's appropriate to staff. Since I took office on January 1st of 2001, there has not been one successful lawsuit filed against the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office. Not one. And that's because of the people we have in place and the management and supervision that they conduct themselves in out there.
Mr. Piper. Sure. Can the sheriff's office be run more efficiently, and if so, what would you do to accomplish that?
I think that, of course, I think it can run more efficiently. That's part of what it takes to run an organization of this size. every year, every month, we need to be looking back at what we're doing, what can be done more efficiently. The economy is in bad shape. We keep taking more and more money. You have to constantly be evaluating what you're doing. What we've done to a degree is when we have a new program that we're starting, something new that we're going to start doing, what we're doing, we keep building on. We're never looking back at what we're not necessarily using anymore or what's not effective anymore and cutting out. As a result, we just keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger and not as efficient as we could be. Specifically, what I would do,
Mr. McDonald, in a row. Chef, in a row.
No.
Specifically, what I would do, being a sheriff.
Where did you go? But that's where you go.
You got a minute to respond, so Mr. Piper, go ahead.
Specifically, what I would do, being a sheriff involves some very difficult, very tough decisions. One way to get it more efficient is to flatten the command structure. Right now, the last count I believe we had like 9 steps from a deputy sheriff to up to the sheriff. You take the very top of that structure and flatten it. Make it so there's not so many steps. Communication improves. What the sheriff actually wants done is easier to communicate. I'm sure you've all played that game when we were kids. There was 10 people and you tell a secret at one side, and when it comes out the other end, you don't even recognize it. Take some of those layers out. I'm not talking about cutting people, I'm talking about cutting layers to where the sheriff communicates more effectively what he wants done and how he wants it done.
Our next question, Sheriff Paxton, you lead off on this. What actions will you take as sheriff to help prevent crimes before they occur?
Well, the first thing I do is get out my crystal ball and shine it up and look in the future so everybody can tell me when and where a crime is going to occur. We have a lot of programs going on right now, proactive programs that we work with in the community to do what we can to impact the occurrence of crime. One of them I'm very proud of is our Neighborhood Watch program. That program is built over the last 7 or 8 years where we now have over 300 subdivisions in the county that are actively participating in Neighborhood Watch. As we got that program really up and running, we started to see measurable results. When we combined the years of 06, 07, and 08, we saw a decline in property crimes here right at 33%. We're going to continue to be very aggressive with that particular part of our program. We also have a tremendous number of programs. We work with our senior community and working with them about crimes that are incidental to them, white collar crimes, things such as that.
Mr. Piper, what action would you take as sheriff to help prevent crimes before they occur?
I'm back again to the community-oriented policing model. When you have officers that work a specific area, they know the specific area, they have ownership. They have a relationship with the people who work there. They're more interested and they know what's going on in those specific areas. Sheriff Paxton mentioned the Neighborhood Watch. That is a wonderful program. Can be a whole lot more effective than it is right now. The Neighborhood Watch would be one of the units that actually moves to someplace different in the agency. Neighborhood Watch would be more effective working under patrol division. Communication, we're back again, communication lines. Reorganizing into a more effective, more efficient agency. Same people doing a better job of communicating more closely with the people who actually serve on the streets.
Mr. McDonald, do you need to repeat the question?
You know, you look at the role of the sheriff's office as we all think about serve and protect, and a lot of times it's serve and react, and of course looking at what we can do, and it's everybody in this room, it's up to you to protect yourself. We cannot put a sheriff's deputy in every driveway in this community to protect every citizen in this community. So, you know, it's up to us to do things, whether it's, you know, alarm systems, big dogs, have a gun. I mean, those are things that we choose as with our rights to protect ourselves. But, you know, looking at what we can do as a sheriff's office is, is increasing the relationship with the neighborhood watch program. There are agencies around us. Sandy Springs is going to where these neighborhood watch communities are now getting their own vehicles, and they're patrolling and taking an investment in their community. And I think that's something we really need to look at. As we retire a vehicle out of the fleet, that we may give it to a subdivision for them to pour into their community.
Sheriff Paxton.
Yes, it means big. We keep hearing about community-oriented policing and having deputies assigned to the same area. That is currently the model to be used. They are assigned to the same area. Same deputies work the same precincts of each shift. They're in the same areas. They're very much in tune with what's going on in their territories. Our crime analysis unit is constantly feeding information out to them about what is happening, what's going on, so that they can address those issues. That's happening now. When we talk about the Neighborhood Watch Program and how it can be revamped, you know, in 2009, we received the Award of Excellence from the National Sheriff's Association for our Neighborhood Watch Program here in Forsyth County. I don't know how much better it can get beyond that. At the same time, the National Sheriff's Association, in conjunction with the Office of Justice Administration, came here and did a public service announcement highlighting and spotlighting our Neighborhood Watch Program and the success that it is. And if you wanted to do Neighborhood Watch, do it the way Forsyth County does it.
Mr.
Piper. We have an excellent Neighborhood Watch Program. It was not suggesting that we change it. I was suggesting that we move it would be more effective. Good men and women working in there. They love their jobs. They enjoy them. What I'm suggesting is even better than we are. As far as the community-oriented policing model, deputies do at this point work sometimes the same zone. However, every 3 months there's a watch preference shift, so they're doing that anyway. So it's not quite as, the continuity isn't quite what it could be. That's it.
Chief Bell. Next question from Mr. Piper. Why are you a Republican, and with which Republican principles do you most identify?
My parents were Republicans. I guess I was the way I was raised. I came up a Republican. I didn't know you were supposed to be anything else originally. As I grew up and got a little bit older, I started realizing why my parents were Republicans and why I was going to stay a Republican. What I most identify with is what the Republicans say with regard to fiscal responsibility and limited government, constitutionally limited government. My only problem with the Republican Party right now is a lot of people and a lot of our elected officials here in this county say that they're Republicans and they espouse these values, but they don't actually act on it. They really have to deploy Democrats. Fiscal responsibility in the Constitution and limited government is probably the strongest thing.
Identify Mr. McDonald?
Well, I personally, I don't like donkeys. I look at the way I was raised, my family values. You know, going back to as a kid, as an only child, my dad expected certain things out of me. And I have those values today that I expect them out of my children. And I think the Republican Party I wish, you know, we would look more at the mission and what it teaches us and it represents. Because I think sometimes we do get off base. We might call ourselves Republicans when we're really not. And, you know, I look at in my personal business, the ethics and the leadership that I give there. That's what a Republican is. It's a leader and the values that it has in our lives. You know, the Ten Commandments. You know, we need to get back to that. We need to look at one of the first tablets that was placed on this earth. And we need to kind of read that every day and get back to the basics.
Sheriff Paxton, why are you a Republican, and
With which Republican principle do you most identify?
I'm a Republican because that's the only thing to be. I've always been conservative. I obviously can speak to what my vote on. It's starting very basically with my family, their values, or what we came up, conservative values. And I certainly identified with that in my own life. And certainly really irritates me to see the role of government expanded, how more and more people believe that government is supposed to take care of every one of their needs and treat it in any space. So that is why I'm a Republican. I've been a member of this party here for almost 20 years, the local Republican Party. The most, one of the ideals I recognize with the most, I guess, is I would say personal responsibility. Personal responsibility.
Mr. Piper, anything you want to add? Mr. McDonald? Chair Paxton?
No.
Mr. McDonald? What improvements do you see the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office needing to make in the next 4 years, and how do you plan to accomplish this?
I think
these can be capital improvements or process improvements.
Well, you know, I look at the largest capital improvements going to be our jail. As the next sheriff, when voted on SPLOS, we voted on a number. We didn't vote on what we're going to build. We didn't have a clue. That hadn't even been designed yet. We voted on, all right, we're going to give $50 million from the citizens to the county to build a jail. If I personally went to the bank and said, give me $2 million, I'm going to build a business, I better have a plan. I better go to that bank and say, this is what I'm going to build. I better show the foundation. I better show the structure. I better have a budget. But you know, I think the most important thing that we need to really look at is what we're going to have in this jail. What is going to be the footprint of our downtown, our city? Because that is where they say they're going to build the jail as a downtown coming. And we've now placed $50 million in our leader's hands, and we don't know what we're going to get yet. I think that's the most important thing right now.
Chair Paxton, what improvements do you see the Sheriff's Office needing to make in the next 4 years? How would you accomplish this?
Well, the most needed improvement, once again, I speak to what Mr. McDonald said, was serving the jail. That is one of the biggest issues we've had looming with us here locally, and such a need for. Because what it has caused us to do as a county is to expend a tremendous amount of money to house prisoners over in other jails. At twice the daily rate of what it costs us to keep them here locally. And so at the end of the day, the payoff is going to be back to the people here. Beyond that, as far as the Sheriff's Office is concerned, there are a few things that we need as far as technology, equipment-wise. We've seen back in 05 or 06, we started to transition into the current communication system, but some of that's starting to get a little dated, and we're looking at opportunities and ways in which we will be able to some of that and keep it in good operation condition. Thank you.
Mr. Piper, what improvements do you see the Sheriff's Office needing to make in the next 4 years, and how would you accomplish this?
I would hope that if I'm elected, I would constantly be looking at where I can improve on. But the one of the immediate needs, I would think, would be a policy man. We currently have a policy manual that's about 1,000 pages long, modeled on other agencies. But we have immediately have a policy manual written that was Forsyth County specific and specific to our agency. Another thing we've done is a money saving type of thing. An actual tracking procedure. Vehicles are a major expense or major cost for a law enforcement agency. We have to have the mobility. We presently don't actually have set. I'll finish my report.
It's got 15 seconds.
All right, we'll move to Mr. McDonald. Would you like to add anything?
Yeah, I think, you know, looking at our community, one of the main things we need to do, everybody knows the technology world, everybody probably three quarters of people when you have a smartphone. We need to look at supplying these deputies with AEDs, having AEDs out on the road, because they are the first line resource when something's going on at home, and also making each deputy first responder qualified. Because when someone has a need, the deputy's always first ones there. I've seen it in 24 years of public safety as a fireman. The deputy's always on the first one on the scene. They are a vital resource when someone is either having a heart attack or a diabetic situation, that they may can go in there and be a first line of first aid for individuals. So, you know, I think that's important, something that we need to look at, because the deputies are out on the road. I think we also need to have AVLs, which are automatic vehicle locators, so we know where these deputies are out on the road, and that will be a better resource for 911 to be able to send people to certain situations.
Sheriff, would you like to add anything?
Yeah, I mean, it certainly sounds good to have AEDs and all patrol cars. The problem is all the deputies are busy answering calls for service of crime-related issues. They're not typically going to be the first responders, because they're obviously doing other things more germane to the office of sheriff. Mention was made about the toy manual being too cumbersome, too big. Yeah, we do have an employee manual, policy manual that meets over 400 standards, which are required by our accreditation, by the Commission on Accreditation for Law Enforcement Agencies. They are very, very comprehensive. They are, once again, directed to all law enforcement, not just here in Forsyth County, but everywhere else. You better have a very comprehensive manual. We're in the law enforcement business. Bottom line is, by that manual, 11 pages is all of it is, confines what is behavior. What behavior is 11 minutes. And that manual saves us an insurance cost, $51,000 a year, by being accredited by CALEA. It's what the savings is to this county in liability insurance. Thank you.
Sheriff Paxton. Many illegal immigrants are housed in our jail system. Is it appropriate to call immigration officials to have them deported?
We do have some illegal immigrants in our jail, but understand, if they are in our jail, they are charged with a violation of a state law, and they are awaiting adjudication of their case in the appropriate court. We have no authority as a local law enforcement agency to enforce federal law, and the immigration laws of this country are federal law, and we are not authorized to enforce them. Meaning that we simply cannot and do not take someone into custody just because they may be in this country illegally. Everyone that is an illegal alien and in this country illegally is in our jail, or once again awaiting trial for some criminal offense. Just because they're in this country illegally does not mean they get a free pass on what they've been charged with. Once their case is adjudicated, at that point, if they're ready to be released, we do notify Immigration and Customs, and they take the appropriate action to deport them or move them out to some facility. Thank you.
Mr. Piper, is it appropriate to call immigration officials when illegal aliens are housed in South Carolina?
Can I clarify that? When we arrest one, on one's housing?
I wanted to restate the question. It was in relation to Pete's questions. That many illegal immigrants are housed in our jail system. Do you believe it's appropriate to call immigration officials to get them deported?
I'll answer both ways. I think anytime we come in contact with somebody that we suspect of being illegal alien, we should follow all of the remedies that we have to us, whether it's an arrest, whether it's somebody that we're arresting ourselves or housing for somebody else. If we're in contact with them in that way, or they're in our custody, I think we should take every avenue available to us legally to make sure the immigration knows about them, and if we can, deport them, or have immigration deport them. Like the sheriff said, we don't have the authority to do that ourselves, but I think we should use every avenue we have legally.
Mr. McDonald?
Well, as the sheriff said, I mean, if they're in the jail and incarcerated waiting for trial, you know, I do not want them out on the street. working with ICE and immigration, I think that we need to have a direct communication with them when there's a traffic stop out on the road, that the possibility of someone doesn't, if they don't have insurance or they don't have the proper ID, and, you know, you detain them. I think that communication with ICE, then have them come in and let them make the decision on whether to deport or release. You know, you don't want to put our county and your tax dollars in a liable state. So, you know, I think that's their responsibility, the federal government. You know, we hate to say let's depend on them, but they do hold the laws that govern in immigration.
Chair Paxton,
like that? We currently do work very closely with the Department of Homeland Security and Immigration and Customs. Our agency does participate in a program that's called Secure Communities, where everyone who comes into the jail has fingerprinted. Those fingerprints are run against the database, which includes the Immigration and Customs database. Anybody that we do have in custody that has been recognized by them and as a criminal alien, we are notified immediately to put a detainer on them. And once again, as soon as their case is adjudicated, Immigration does come and pick them up. We've worked very closely with them over the years and we'll continue to have a very close relationship with them.
Thank you, Scott. Any addition? Mr. Dunn, any addition? Mr. Piper, how will the new justice complex change the responsibility of the sheriff's office? And why are you the best candidate to address these new responsibilities?
I don't think it changes the responsibility. I think it gives us more room. I think it gives the sheriff's office more room. I believe it could possibly, at that point, we may be able to cut down some of the numbers that we have to use for the court system that we can reassign someplace else. It won't be in so many different places. We'll have a more contained area. Also, with the new jail being built, this, the one that we're in right now is 1970s technology, very linear, manpower intensive. I'm assuming that the new jail will be built in more modern practices where it's less manpower intensive.
Mr. McDonald?
Well, as you say, we don't know what we're going to have right at this moment. I mean, they're still in the very early planning stages. Hopefully the designers, commissioners, sheriff at this point will use all resources to implement great technology, safety, not only for us as a citizen outside the jail, but for the inmates. I mean, they too have rights, and we got to make sure that their safety is met every day, and for the safety of the deputies. I think it will be less intensive on the staff. You know, you'll be able to do a lot with cameras, a lot, you know, moving inmates from place to place without having a hands-on deputy all the time. So I think that's going to be important. Of course, being right next to the courthouse, that will also cut down on gas, staff, etc.
Sheriff Paxton, do you need me to repeat the question?
I think I could recall it. How's it going to change our role? Is that it?
Yes, sir.
And it's not going to change our role. Our role is still going to be the same. We're required by statute law to secure the courthouse. Obviously, we have to operate the jail, but my colleagues are correct. The facilities we're now occupying, the courthouse and also the jail, were both constructed back in the mid-70s when we were not at this point in time in our society, and there was no security features really in mind with the courthouse construction. It just wasn't there. The new courthouse that we designed for to accommodate what is actually needed now in security measures within the courthouse. The jail itself, once again, it is very labor intensive because it is old technology. There's been tremendous increases in penal technology since then, so we will have a more efficient operation. In addition, there's going to be connectivity, secure connectivity, to where we'll be able to move the inmates back and forth from the courthouse to the jail. Without having to get them out of confinement, put them in cars, crank up cars, and burn gas up. So it's going to be a much more efficient operation.
Mr. Piper, anything about that?
The only thing I'd add is I'm not sure the process has been a little bit confusing with funding the jail and all that stuff. I'm not sure how much input the sheriff is being allowed to have, but as a new sheriff, I would exert any input that I did have to try to get that thing moved out of downtown. I don't know if that's possible. I don't know if it's legal. I've not researched it. But I personally don't want my downtown area, or the small towns, or rural community like we've got, a beautiful downtown, turned into a government center. And that's what we're about to do. If it was my preference, and if I had any influence, I would do what I could to get moved.
Mr. McDonald, anything you'd like to add?
Do I get that?
I'm sorry. Yes. Sorry. Chair, go ahead.
I am on the steering committee and planning for the new courthouse and jail. We have a very substantial role in that process. But as a sheriff, it is the sheriff's responsibility to operate the county's jail. It is not the sheriff's jail, it is the county's jail, by virtue of which it is the governing authority of the county, meaning the five people that usually sit up here at meetings. It is their responsibility to decide where the building's going to be built. So they make that decision. And moving it outside of town, we still have this reality is that the courthouse is still right here. So if we move the jail way outside of town somewhere, we're going to be right back into an inefficient operation, as much as we're going to have to be taking them out of a secure environment, get them in the cars, vans, load them up, haul them into town, back and forth each day, which is once again dedicates more personnel. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheriff. All right, Mr. McDonald. How will your experiences guide your decision making during an emergency?
Throughout my 24 years in public safety, I've had to make life decisions. There's many times that I, as an EMT, that I've been on the scene that when you've had a serious wreck, and at that wreck, I've had to pick which patient to take, knowing that other patients may die. That's one of the toughest decisions you'll ever make. We talk about in the first debate, they said, well, what about a hostage situation? You know, I will have the right people in place to make those decisions. Yes, ultimately, the sheriff is the person that makes the decision whether you're going to take a criminal out or not. And hopefully that will never happen. I don't know how many times these gentlemen have had to make that decision as an employee of the Sheriff's Department in Forsyth County. I don't recall any. I know we've had an officer that has had to shoot a bank robber. In that, he didn't have to call the sheriff and say, Sheriff, can I shoot that bank robber? He had to make a decision. And he made the right decision. Unfortunately, we wish that would never happen, but it did. And we hire 25-year-olds. They go to post. We put them through training. We give them a gun. We give them a badge. And the car goes 150 miles an hour with a license to kill. And it's tough. We put a lot of pressure on these deputies. And
Sheriff Paxton, how does your experience guide your decision making during an emergency?
My experience is what drives my decision making in any type of emergency. Certainly in situations where you may have a hostage situation, somebody can barricade in a house. Yes, certainly you got SWAT teams there, and you're going to have staff members there. And yes, you seek their counsel and information about what their assessment is in the situation. And yes, the decision does rest with me. The difference is I understand the principles, the laws, the court cases which my staff is utilizing and advising me on. I have a clear knowledge and understanding of those as well. Therefore, knowing what is the right decision and the right way to go. And they're very critical decisions that have been made in the past. They will be made again in the future. We certainly don't want to have a situation to get out of hand like it did a couple of weeks ago in Cherokee County, where unfortunately, that's why people were placed in a position where they had to take a life of a 16-year-old boy. And that was a very, very sad situation to have.
Mr. Piper.
Without the experience that I have, I'm quite frankly terrified of this job. Tough decisions are required of the sheriff every day. if I didn't have a background, 25-year background, if I didn't have some leaders that I looked up to that had taught me as I came through, I would be terrified to take this job. If you're not terrified to take a job like this with no experience, you've never done it, if you don't understand the laws, if you don't know the case law, if you haven't worked with the case law, if you don't know the application of the case law, you can read books all day long. It looks different when you see it. If you can't put all that together, you can't make proper decisions. Having a good staff is important. I prefer my staff all be brighter than me. But if just in case they're not, the only reason for the sheriff to be there is because your staff can't handle something anymore. It's a decision that has to be made by you. You cannot be the least experienced person there. You need to be the most experienced. Quite frankly, 10 years ago, I don't think I could have handled it, this job. And that was after 15 years of law enforcement. You must have a certain level before you can take a job like this.
Mr. McDonald, you respond. Chair Paxton?
No, sir.
Mr. Piper? Chair Paxton, what actions would you take to improve the community image of the sheriff's office?
I will continue to do as we're doing today with the service we provide to the people in the community, our presence out on the street, our neighborhood watch program, our constant interaction with people in the community. It's all we can do. Don't give us to have improve the image. I think our image is excellent. Our image is respected throughout the law enforcement community, not only through the metro Atlanta area, but statewide. We are respected law enforcement agency, and I'm very happy with what we've gotten to, and we'll continue doing it in the same way. Thank you.
Mr. Piper.
Some of the best men and women have been in law enforcement work here at the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office. I think they have a good image. But once again, if you can't be complacent with what we have, you should constantly be trying to improve, constantly trying to think specifically, how do I do to try to change a little bit of a change of culture more to a, I don't want to use the word service, but I don't want to sound like I'm preaching, but if you're trying to get rich, law enforcement or any type of public safety is the wrong place to go. You're not going to be rich. It's almost a calling. And I think sometimes we get to be, especially when we turn into more of a bureaucracy than a law enforcement agency, I think you forget that you're actually here to serve. I believe that's going to lead the agency in the direction of culture change, more service culture.
Mr. McGill.
Yeah, one of the main things I think that the program you would implement is a customer service department. I mean, I think that the citizen asks the customer, you know, when a lot of times when we're around the deputy, you know, are we nervous? If we get pulled over, yes, our heart rate increases. And, you know, we need to have a good feeling when we're around a deputy. And I think that's one of the most important things that we can do is teach these deputies who the customer is out there. We've got great men and women that serve in this department, but I think, you know, we could do a better job. I've seen it out there on accidents when individuals going down the road, they don't understand what that deputy wants them to do. And I've seen deputies, unfortunately, get very upset that person didn't do the right thing. And that person out there is the customer. And I think we need to do a better job of working with our community that way.
Chair Paxton, Mr. Piper, Mr. Young, any additional? All right. Mr. Piper, please assess the gang situation for South County and tell us your strategies to combat it.
I don't believe the gang situation is the problem that it was 4, 5, 6 years ago. At one point, we were having increasing problem with the gangs. As the building industry has gone down, and some of a lot of the illegals have left the area, a lot of the gang problem with them. We still have, to some extent of it, but not to the extent that we did have in the county. That's my assessment of it. How to address it is, again, through training. We're focusing our priorities, where we're putting our money at. Give the officers the training, let them prove themselves. give them options in return.
I'd taken some gang training back in December, and just four months ago, my third grader came home and did a gang sign, and I said, "Why? Where did you learn that?" He said, "A fifth grader taught it to me." So you can see the kids. That's why we've got to get in our kids' lives to let them know what they're seeing, what they're doing, and what those ramifications will be. You see on TV people making signs. I mean, it's kids all the time doing things with their fingers, and they don't know what they're doing. And as that goes on, you never know what that's going to lead to. As far as knowing what our gang problem is in the community, I don't know that at this point. But I'm sure there is issues and pockets out there. We just need to make sure that we have the resources that are available when they do pop up, that we respond to them efficiently.
Chair Paxton.
Yes. Excuse me. We have had in the past some incidents of what we suspected would be gang-related crimes. However, over the last several years, we have seen a sharp drop-off in that. There's been two things that's impacted it. Number one, several years ago, we joined in with the Cherokee County Sheriff's Office as well as the FBI on a joint gang task force to try to get out in front of the problem. We've seen a lot of issues, obviously. People watch the news down around Norcross, across the lake over in Hall County and Gainesville. A lot of things. So we want to get on the front end of it and try to curb it before it got strong over here. The other thing that certainly impacted it is the reality. Gangs are typically born out of the Hispanic community, and we have seen we've had a significant decline in that population here in Forsyth County because of the drying up of labor, the decline in the economy. They're just not here like they were.
Mr. Piper, any? Mr. McDonald? All right. Our final question for each of the candidates, there won't be a rebuttal of this. We'll start with Mr. McDonald. Who did you vote for in the 2008 presidential general election?
John McCain.
John McCain.
John McCain. You'd be surprised at the answers we got for that question over the years, but we do want to make sure that folks are dedicated to the Republican Party. We appreciate your willingness to get involved.
I was just kidding. Is he still out there? I haven't seen him in a while. So,
very good. Well, thank you, gentlemen. We're now moving into our final phase of the debate. We will start with, I think we'll start on this end of the stage, and whatever this is called. We'll start with Mr. Piper. If you could give a minute and a half closing statement.
I'm basically going to give you a recap of my opening statement. 25 years of law enforcement. I know it. 25 years of law enforcement, broad range of experience. What it comes down to is leadership and budgets. Our budget, once again, has tripled at the same time as the population has only gone up by 78%. There is no logical explanation for that other than we're not doing some of the things we talked about here today. We're not looking at what we don't need anymore. We're not looking at what we're doing and constantly getting better. We're going to have to make a change. The change needs to be made. It needs to be made before we still got a handle on this. I listened to some of the commissioners' debates yesterday, and I was shocked. I did not know how deeply in debt our county is. The hundreds of millions of dollars, if I'm not mistaken, of debt that's coming on to us. The sheriff's office controls 41% of the county's overall operating budget. That's a tax driver. I'll do my part to get us out of that debt, to get us out of debt. Thank you.
Chair Paxton.
Thank you. Once again, I'd just like to thank all of each and every one of you for being here. Once again, to recap, I have had the honor and distinct pleasure to serve this community as your sheriff since 2001. I look forward to continuing to serve in that capacity. You know, we talk about a lot of things. We talk about budgets. We talk about comparing to this entity, that entity. People want to do that. Just go check it out for yourself. It's very hard to compare two or any more of them on their surface because every county does their budgeting and their figures in a different way. So please seek out what is actually true. Once again, I'm standing on my record of what we've done, what we've accomplished, where we've come to. We have a community that is very safe, you're correct. But I will counter that the reason it is very safe is because of the work that we have done, the way we've trained the deputies, how they've applied that out in the field, the many programs we have in place. That's why we are where we are today. It's been my pleasure to serve you as your sheriff, and I look forward to continuing to serve in that capacity. Thank you so much.
Mr. McDonald.
Again, I want to thank Mr. Underwood, the party. Thank you all for coming out tonight. I want to thank this community for its support of my family over the years personally, the support y'all have given me as your coroner over the past 11 and a half years. As your next sheriff, I want to give you my values, my ethics, my leadership, my trust, my character. It's demanded at my home. I want to offer that to you. It's needed in this community. We've got a lot of challenges coming up. And as your next sheriff, I will meet those challenges. And I won't let you down, I promise you. Again, thank you for being here tonight.
Gentlemen, thank you very much. We appreciate you being here. Folks, just give them a round of applause. I hope everyone will stay for one. A little known fact that some of people may not be aware of, that in the event of a vacation at the sheriff's office, the coroner can be called to serve in his stead. So coroner is a very important office. I hope that you will stay and participate in our debates. They'll be starting at 7:45. We'll take a brief break until then. Thank you.